Good morning, everybody. Welcome to St. John Presbyterian Church. My name is Alan, and I'm the pastor here, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to worship, whether you are in person or watching on the rebroadcast on YouTube. I have just a few announcements this morning. Our talent show is this Saturday at 5 o'clock. The 5 o'clock will be a time where we can gather around our taco and potato bar, and then our talent show starts at 5:45, so come out and support the talented friends and family of St. John Presbyterian Church. And I think there's an insert in your bulletin one last time to let us know whether or not you'll be coming and who you are bringing with you. Per capita is due, that's $50.15. For all active members, per capita goes to cover the administrative costs of the Presbytery Synod and General Assembly. And our adult Sunday school is back up and running at 9:30 on Sunday mornings. They're currently studying the book of Proverbs. So if you want to join them, I think they're on the next five chapters of Proverbs. So read 6 through 11. And you can join them at 9:30 on Sunday mornings. We also have a sermon club that meets on Wednesday mornings at 10:30. That's a group where we gather together to discuss the text from the previous and upcoming weeks of sermons. So if you have Wednesday morning free and want to join us, that's the sermon club at 10:30 on Wednesdays. To the inclement weather, we had to cancel Charlie's recital on Friday. That has been rescheduled for March 24th. So you'll want to mark your calendars that Charlie's recital is now March 24th. Any other announcements this morning? Anna. So if you want to support Emery and Eloise, they have a fundraiser they're both leading. So you can contact them during coffee call and ask them all about it. Other announcements? How about prayer concerns? How can we pray this morning? We continue to pray for Vicky's sister, Paula, and for you, Vicky, as well, as you take care of her. Any other joys or concerns this morning? All right, seeing none, we'll invite Charlie to share his prelude. Thank you.
morning. Please stand if you are able and join me in the call to worship. In this season of discipleship, God calls us to leave our comfortable lives. On sleepless nights, in fear's shadows, we toss and turn with doubt's questions. Reluctant to deny ourselves, convinced that everything depends on us. In this season of discipleship, we long to follow Jesus. Confession of sin. You call us to become pilgrims, to follow you in a journey by faith. We would find it easier to follow when not so much is at stake. But you promise that you will be with us and that our needs will be met. We cling to our possessions, trusting in them for security. You lead us into unfamiliar places, asking that we trust in your will. O God, your way is challenging when we choose to be complacent. You make great demands. We are anxious and uncertain. Have mercy upon us and forgive our hesitant steps toward the promise. The good news is that God forgives us. Forgive others and forgive yourselves. Our first reading this morning is Matthew 20, verses 1 through 16. The laborers in the vineyard. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them into his vineyard. When he went out about 9, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, "You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. When he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around, and he said to them, "Why are you standing here idle all day?" They said to him, "Because no one has hired us." He said to them, "You also go into the vineyard." When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, "Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first." When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received their usual daily wage. And when they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, "These last worked only 1 hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat." But he replied to them, "Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree with me for the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous?" So the last will be first, and the first will be last. Thus ends the first reading.
Our second reading continues in Matthew 20 with verse 17. While Jesus was going up to Jerusalem, he took the 12 disciples aside by themselves and said to them on the way, "See, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be handed over to the chief priests and scribes, and they will condemn him to death. Then they will hand him over to the Gentiles to be mocked and flogged and crucified, and on the third day he will be raised." It's the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Lord, open our ears to hear you, open our minds to know you, open our mouths to praise you, open our hearts to love you, and open our lives to serve you. May the words of my mouth and meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Today's scripture passage sheds some insight on the labor practices of the day. Jesus would often use common scenarios to teach people about the kingdom of heaven. Here he uses the practice of hiring day laborers. Most people didn't have the good fortune of having permanent employment, so they went to the public marketplace to be hired out in the morning. This is exactly how our parable begins, with a wealthy landowner going to hire men to work in the vineyard first thing in the morning. But then an amazing thing happens. He goes back time and time again. That there were laborers standing idle late in the day shows us how scarce it was to find work. But that the landowner still hired them shows us the size of his vineyard and the breadth of work that needed to be done. The landowner in this story, of course, is God, and then the vineyard is the world. In Matthew 9, verses 35 to 38, the Gospels tell us, then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. In this passage, Jesus shows us that the harvest is about teaching the word, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, participating in healing, and most of all, having compassion for the harassed and helpless. He says that the harvest is plentiful. There is much need in the world to be met. But he says that the laborers are few. In today's passages, we see that the laborers are there. They just arrive on their own time schedule, the one set by God. Some are there from the get-go. Others come along halfway there. And still others come along at the 11th hour, just in the nick of time. In the parable, we are to see that the Jews were the first to be asked to go work in the vineyard. Those who come along later in the parable are the Gentiles, those to whom the gospel had just been opened and are being given a late start. But still they are working in the vineyard, happy for anything they might receive. The Apostle Paul would later establish this same pattern in his letter to the Romans, to whom he wrote, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel. It is the power of God for salvation to everyone who has faith, to the Jew first and also to the Greek." In Matthew 15, a Canaanite woman had come to Jesus, begging for him to heal her daughter. He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep, to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." Jesus had seen his primary mission to be that to his own people, Israel. But just as the woman said that even dogs are grateful for even the crumbs that fall from the table, so would she be grateful. And he commended her for her faith. How Jesus' view of his call had changed by the time he told this parable, because the most extraordinary and outrageous thing happens. The law demanded that day laborers be paid at the end of each day. So when the landowner went to settle his accounts, he gave each group a daily wage, including those who had only started at the 11th hour. The others grumbled, saying that this group should receive the same as those who sweated and labored all day long. But the landowner said, "Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give this last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am so generous?" Jesus then repeats the sentiment of chapter 19, verse 30, when he says, "So the last will be first, and the first will be last." The man gave to each the same amount, a day's wage, because that's what he chose to do. Of course, the other workers had every reason to be outraged, but Jesus is speaking about the kingdom of God. There it is not about how far you have come, but how much God loves you. It's not when you get on board, it's that you get on board. It's not when you answer the call, it's that you answer the call. God's grace is no different for the one who has been a cradle-to-grave Christian, raised in the church and never wavering, than it is for the one who is just new to the faith. Grace is the same for the first and the last. Grace is the same wherever you are on your journey of faith. The point is not when we get to work, but that we get to work in the kingdom. You may have backslided. You may hesitate about volunteering. You just don't have the time or energy. But sometimes working in this kingdom is as simple as starting a GoFundMe account for someone. Sometimes working in the kingdom means taking the lead in a Bible study. Sometimes working in the kingdom means singing in the choir, leading worship, hosting coffee call. Working in the kingdom means seeing the world as God's vineyard, where the harvest is plenty, but the laborers are few. We have a responsibility for sharing the good news of the kingdom, having compassion to those in need, and standing up for the harassed and helpless. Making a friend, being a friend, and bringing that friend to Christ. That's the work of the kingdom, and we are all called to serve as laborers. Whether we're young or old, rich or poor, liberal or conservative, whether we've grown up in church all our lives or had our time when we slipped away for a while, whether we're long-time or first-time believers, we have a call to work in the vineyard and the promise that we have the same grace that covers a multitude of sins. Grace isn't so much a reward as it is the gift of doing a good day's work. The peace of knowing you did something good for someone. The joy of knowing that you matter because you matter to someone. Of knowing that in your life you have just done something to reflect the love, the grace, and the justice of Jesus Christ and his kingdom. Grace tells us that it doesn't matter how long we've been faithful, but God is faithful, each of us equal. Our parable shows us that God doesn't show favorites. So why be faithful? Why work extra hard if you're just going to get the same grace in the end as everyone else? In Galatians, we read, "For you were called to freedom, brothers and sisters. Only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for self-indulgence, but through love become slaves to one another. For the whole law is summed up in a single commandment: you shall love your neighbor as yourself." We aren't called by grace to serve ourselves. We are called to serve one another in love. That's what it means to labor in the vineyard, to labor in love with one another. Jesus knew that the call of grace wasn't easy and that sometimes it wasn't fair. He told his disciples for the third time that the Son of Man would be handed over to the chief priests and scribes, who would condemn him to death and hand him over to the Gentiles, who would mock, flog, and crucify him. But on the third day, he said, he will be raised. For Jesus, his labor in the vineyard was to die for the vineyard. No one else is called to die for the vineyard, but we are called to make sacrifices. We are to emulate Christ's sacrifice in our own way as we take up our cross daily. And sometimes that means carrying it through the vineyard. Isaiah sung of the Lord's vineyard in chapter 5 of the book credited to his name. "Let me sing for my beloved my love song concerning his vineyard. My beloved had a vineyard on a very fertile hill. He dug it and cleared it of stones and planted it with choice vines. He built a watchtower in the midst of it and hewed out a wine vat in it. He expected it to yield grapes, but it yielded wild grapes." The Lord said that because of this, the vineyard would be torn down and trampled. In the days of Jesus, he died so that the vineyard could thrive. So that instead of wild grapes, we might produce the sweet grapes of peace, righteousness, faith, hope, and love. Today we gather to bless the fruit of the earth and of the vine that become for us the grace we need. These gifts, the sustenance we need to go and labor in the vineyard. For the world is indeed full of wild grapes, sour grapes, and rotten grapes. We are called to make the world a place where love grows warm, peace grows strong, hope draws ever more certain, and grace is extended to all. May we be those willing to help Jesus bring his kingdom in our midst, waiting for God to call our name and do our part in the vineyard harvest that God has planned for us. Amen.
Joy to meet my Lord, forgiven love and
Join me in the affirmation of faith, which we take from the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from whence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. Believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the remission of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Join me in the call to the table. The God of faith journeys be with you. People of God, offer your hearts to the one who keeps them. Sing praises to the one who transforms despair into hope. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for your good graces. You created us in your image, but we failed to live up to that image. We have been a people who have been faithful and walk close to you, and we have also been a people who have been unfaithful and walked far from you. You sent your prophets with the great message of return. Return to me, you said, for I am your God and you are my people. But we have failed to live as your people. We have failed to labor in your vineyard. We have failed to do the good that we ought to do. We have sinned in your sight and in the sight of others. We have been unforgiving, cruel, and hateful. And yet your Son came to die for us. It was while we were yet sinners that Christ died for us. And we gather around this table knowing our brokenness, knowing our flaws and imperfections, and knowing how we have sinned against you. And yet you welcome us here by your grace. It is your Son's invitation that draws us here to renew our fellowship with you and with one another. You restore us into a right relationship, so that we might stand worthy in your presence. Give us the grace we need to make it through each and every day. May this be our daily bread, the life that alone we need to be living. Holy Spirit, anoint these gifts of the earth and of the vine, and make them the means by which we embrace God's grace in this moment and respond to it with a life of Christian action. We pray this through Christ, who with God the Father and Holy Spirit reigns in the glory of the power that is love. Amen. On the night of his arrest, Jesus shared a meal with his disciples. And as part of that meal, he took bread. And after giving thanks for it, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Take, eat, and do this, remembering me." In the same way, after supper, Jesus took a cup. And after giving thanks for it, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is the cup of the new covenant, sealed in my blood poured out for the forgiveness of sin. Take and drink and do this remembering me. As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim Christ's saving death until he comes. And my body is real food, and my blood is real drink. Whoever eats this bread and drinks from this cup will live in me, and I will live in them. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Join me in the prayer after the supper. Loving God, you graciously feed us who have received these holy mysteries with the bread of life and the cup of eternal salvation. May we who have received this sacrament be strengthened in your service. We who have sung your praises tell of your glory and truth. We've seen the greatness of your love, see you face to face in your kingdom. For you have made us your own people by the death and resurrection of your Son, our Lord, and the life-giving power of your Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. Creator God, you've given us a world with warm sunny days and blustery cold ones. You send the wind and the rain, and you bathe us with glorious sunshine. You've placed the birds in the air and the creatures on the earth. You have given us our pets. You have given us all the animals to love and care for. Help us to be good stewards of your creation as you asked Adam and Eve to be. Creator God, you created us to be your people. You created us in community to be a community. Help us live out the peace, purity, and unity of that community as together we come before you as faithful and loving individuals of Christ's body. Redeemer God, you came to save us when we could not save ourselves. You came to redeem us for yourself to be that people of God. Today you have fed us with your body and your blood to strengthen and nourish us for good work in your kingdom this day and forevermore. The harvest is plenty, but the laborers are few. Help us to be those who go and do our part to spread your good news among all the peoples of this earth. Sustaining God, you sanctify us by Holy Spirit and make us holy as you are holy. You make us more Christ-like each and every day. Help us to live into that identity so that when people see us, they hear Christ's words, they see Christ's actions, and they feel Christ's love. We pray for our church. We pray for our fantastic music department and our music director. We pray for our deacons and elders and trustees. We pray for those who volunteer their time with our youth and to lead adult Sunday school classes. We thank you for the opportunity to serve you through Hope Southern Indiana and ask your blessings on that organization. We thank you for the opportunities you give us to host tax preparation services, and the retired senior volunteer program, and for all the good that they do in our community. We thank you for our part in the Ecumenical Association of Churches, where together we learn what it's like to be unified in the gospel despite our differences. Catholic and Protestant churches, black and white churches coming together, all to consider your purpose and our witness to this community. Almighty God, be with our nation and its leaders. Give them a spirit of bipartisanship and cooperation as they make decisions for all they serve, not just a select few. May there be justice in our land. May there be equality. May there be a celebration of our rich diversity. May there be honest conversations about where we come from and where we are going. Help us to be kind to one another. Help us to be faithful to our founding values. And be with those who lead us in the armed forces. Be also with those who lead us on the state and local level as well. We pray for those who are experiencing homelessness. We pray for those who are battling addiction. We pray for those who are going through divorces. We pray for those who are broken in mind, body, or spirit. We pray healing for the one who is battling cancer, leukemia, dementia, and other such diseases of the mind and the body. We pray for hospice care and the volunteers who offer their time to spend the last moments with someone and make that a peaceful and quality of life time. Be with those who are so desperate that they would think of ending their own life. Be with the one in such despair, not knowing where their next meal will come from. Be with families doing their best just to hold themselves together. Be with those who are seeking gainful employment. Be wisdom for the one who has a difficult decision they have to make. Be courage for the one who is facing a trial. Be strength for all of us on this journey of life as you bring peace to this entire world. Be with Paula as she battles cancer, and be with Vicky as she tries to support her. Be with Dave and Nancy and others in our church who are battling cancer and other such diseases. Be with those who grieve. Be with those who are feeling down and left behind. And now I invite my brothers and sisters to offer any petitions they have to you. Give us wisdom to know that your answers come in your way, and patience knowing that they come in your time. Hear us as we pray. Almighty and triune God, unite our hearts with all the saints on earth and in heaven as we pray as Jesus taught us, standing and singing the Lord's Prayer. With generous hearts, let us give as we are able as our ushers come forward to collect the offering. Let us pray. Almighty God, you are the giver of all good gifts. We give back a portion of what you have given us so that you might use it to encourage, equip, and inspire your community through the life and the mission of this church. We pray this through Christ, the greatest gift of all, and in his name, amen.
In the prayer of the day. Almighty God, whose Son was revealed in majesty before he suffered death upon the cross. Give us faith to perceive his glory, that we may be strengthened to bear our cross and be changed into his likeness from glory to glory. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
May the light of Christ surround you. May the love of Father God enfold you. May the power of Holy Spirit protect you. And may the presence of God watch over you. And remember, wherever you are, God is, and all will be well. Go in peace.